probably why I think that the kind of mainstream classical economic approaches of the last century are not fit to meet the compounding challenges of climate change, environmental degradation, and inequality that we face today. So I'd like to set the scene for my talk with a very simple but important graph. It really can't tell us very much on its own, but I think it's a backdrop to what I think is one of the most important questions in economics today. Are economic growth and the traditional tools of mainstream economics capable of, or really compatible with meeting Paris Agreement targets? So this graph contains World Bank data representing the change in global greenhouse gas emissions, which is the red line here, and also the change in global GDP, which is the blue line, from 1970 to 2012. So on the left here, we've got trillions of US dollars, and on the right, billions of tons of carbon equivalent emissions. So what this graph can show us is that the two trends here have historically followed a very similar path. So as GDP increases, so do carbon emissions and greenhouse gas emissions more generally. How close these two lines match and how closely they follow the same trend really tells us something important about the relationship between these two factors. If this relationship is weakening over time, then we can say that the two factors are decoupling. So the lines become less closely matched over time. Fairly intuitive. But there's an important distinction to be made between two types of coupling or decoupling. We have relative decoupling and absolute decoupling. So, relative decoupling describes an increase in the carbon efficiency of each dollar of economic growth. In other words, in a relative decoupling scenario, each additional dollar of economic growth is associated with a smaller and smaller quantity of additional greenhouse gas emissions. So this means that although the economy is becoming more carbon efficient per dollar, as long as the total volume of dollars or the GDP continues to increase, so do the carbon emissions. This needs to be contrasted, so this can be seen through this kind of blue line, but we see a sort of separating between these two lines, but actually the total greenhouse gas emissions are still increasing. Should be contrasted with the concept of absolute decoupling, which says that even as the economy continues to grow in dollar terms, we see an absolute decrease in the quantity of emissions being emitted into the atmosphere. So, the implications of this difference are significant. There's clear evidence that relative decoupling is happening across a number of economies globally. But can we decouple in an absolute sense? And can we do it fast enough to meet that critical 1.5 degree warming target above pre-industrial levels? So many, like Slido Willis, it will get populated. Many global institutions like the UN Environment Programme, the OECD, and the World Bank would say yes. Specifically, they believe that we can achieve the Paris Agreement targets through something called green growth. Green growth is seen as a win-win for nature, climate, and people, achieving high levels of economic growth whilst also meeting our emissions reductions targets. So it's predicated on this holy grail of absolute and rapid decoupling between carbon emissions and economic growth. But before we look at the evidence for absolute decoupling, I just want to take a moment to kind of reiterate some of what's already been said today about what the kind of scale of what we're trying to achieve through this decoupling process. The best models that we have to date put our total global carbon budget for a 1.5 degree warming target at something in the region of 400 to 600 billion tons of carbon. So the IPCC says that basically what this means is that we have a 66% likelihood of remaining below 1.5 degrees of warming if and only if we're able to limit the total amount and stock of carbon in the atmosphere, emitted into the atmosphere, to below 420 billion tons. We're currently emitting approximately 20 billion tons of carbon into the atmosphere, 40 billion, sorry, into the atmosphere each year, and that number is still continuing to grow. So now the exact number for the carbon budget is contested, can be stretched if we assume the existence of negative emissions technologies, but even the most generous predictions suggest that if we continue emitting at today's rate, we will have used up that carbon budget in less than 20 years, and the majority of estimates have it at under a decade. So the necessary rate of decarbonisation is huge. And according to green growth theory, we need to achieve that decarbonisation while all the while continuing to increase the entire global GDP. That puts us far in excess of any kind of historical trend of decarbonisation. And it's in this context that I want to consider the challenge of decarbonising the economy and decoupling economic growth from GDP, economic growth from GHG emissions. So the IPCC sixth assessment report on 1.5 degrees warming gives 90 mitigation scenarios that would be consistent with achieving the Paris Agreement target and also continuing economic growth. So far, so good. 90 mitigation scenarios sounds like a lot. However, almost every single one of those scenarios relies on the existence of a yet underdeveloped negative emissions technology called bioenergy carbon capture and storage, or BECCS. BECCS is completely untested at large scales. It involves growing large plantations of trees, cutting those trees down, burning them for energy, capturing those carbon emissions at source, and then storing them underground, which sounds simple enough, but in terms of scale, that would mean that by 2050, for a 1.5 degree consistent pathway, BECCS would need to draw down something in the region of 3 to 7 billion tonnes of carbon dioxide from the atmosphere each year. That is, as a conservative estimate, at least 2,000 times more than its global capacity today. Further, in order to meet even a very generous 2 degrees warming target, we would need to cover an area 2 to 3 times the size of India in trees. Think about the difficulty of acquiring that much land. Competition for uses, other kinds of uses like food production, and the potential loss of other types of really important natural habitat. If we consider instead those very few IPCC scenarios which do not rely on this BECCS technology, they instead require a whole host of heroic and rapid changes, which can bring very significant near-term emissions reductions, including a complete transition to 100% renewable energy, mass afforestation, measures to lower energy and land demand, and the total elimination of land use change and industrial process-related emissions. Now, none of this is impossible, technologically or economically, but the best empirical estimates that we have to date suggest that even under highly optimistic policy adoption scenarios, if we continue along a path of unmitigated economic growth, we're very unlikely to achieve the necessary changes to meet the 1.5 degree target. And let's remember here that all of the mainstream actors working on sustainability and climate change rely on green growth being possible and rely on our ability to develop this technology sufficiently quickly that we can reduce our global emissions to net zero in a decade while still continuing to increase the total output of the economy. So the question I end up asking myself is, can we really take this risk? Relying on unproven technologies to save humanity from this existential threat of climate change. If we apply the precautionary principle, given the level of uncertainty that we have about the potential consequences of transgressing these crucial temperature-based thresholds on the Earth's biophysical systems, surely the answer is no. More than this, the likely negative consequences, if we get this gamble wrong, are deeply unequally distributed across the world, with poor equatorial nations suffering the greatest social and environmental burden as a result of our mistake. So this map shows the expected difference in GDP per capita in 2100 as a result of climate change-induced temperature changes, as compared to a no climate change scenario. I think it's very clear who the winners and losers are in this scenario. So where does this leave us? Well, maybe it takes us somewhat backwards towards the 1970s with this kind of classic kind of Baldwin quote. Anyone who believes exponential growth can go on forever in a finite world is either a madman or an economist. These kind of green growth proposals are based on a fundamental idea that the limits to the world's physical systems are flexible, but the structure of our economy is not. This seems to me to be entirely backwards and more a reflection of the importance of politics and power in determining what solutions we see as viable, rather than any reflection of reality per se. So, as these influential global institutions, promoting green growth because they see it as the most viable pathway out of the climate crisis, overcome the limits of nature, can we not lend that same optimism to developing new economic structures and institutions which allow us to grow and flourish as humans in the absence of economic growth? In response to this challenge of how humanity can flourish on a finite planet, new economic approaches are being developed. These approaches accept the biophysical limits of the planet and answer the question of what an economy which is not dependent on or oriented towards economic growth might look like. As you would expect, it's a very complex question, and many of the most fundamental institutions that govern our everyday lives are deeply entwined and reliant on economic growth. So there are two examples of this new economic thinking that I would like to highlight here. The first is donut economics, which was mentioned very briefly, I think, by Alison earlier. It was developed by Kate Raworth during her time as a senior researcher at Oxfam. What this donut says is that there are a set of social foundations which everyone on Earth has an inalienable right to, and a set of biophysical limits beyond which the scale of human activity is unsustainable. And notice that climate change is really only one of those important biophysical limits. It's all about refocusing the goals of our economy and society away from GDP growth and towards directly achieving these human needs targets without transgressing these biophysical limits. Here we find the traditional economic language of efficiency and economic growth wholly insufficient to tackle this reality, and instead we start thinking about language of sufficiency in human needs and biophysical limits. That becomes key to finding a safe space for humanity to flourish. So the next related example I'd like to give is a new field of economic research looking at how we achieve prosperity without growth. It was launched by Tim Jackson during his time as the Economics Commissioner at the UK Sustainable Development Commission. And it looks at more the practical side of transitioning away from a growth-oriented society. Works on the problems of how we can have healthy, functioning economies without economic growth. Asking questions about how we can maintain full employment, under what circumstances individual firms can still grow in a non-growing economy, and what kinds of investment and savings would be compatible with no economic growth. And these are not just nice ideas. The academics and NGOs advancing this kind of economic thinking are working with policymakers, environment departments, treasuries, all party parliamentary groups, that's a difficult one, to develop concrete policy solutions that could start to take us on a transition towards a sustainable and prosperous society. I'll skip over a couple of slides there. I'd also like to address the issue that obviously historically periods of declining economic growth or recession have been pretty bad news for well-being. There's a fantastic book by David Stuckler and Sanjay Basu, who are two public health researchers from the US, which explores this relationship between recession and health and well-being. What they find is that the political decisions taken around a recession largely determine the outcome in terms of health and well-being, rather than any reductions in income per se. So if you take the example of the UK, which opted for a path of austerity during the 2008 recession, and contrast it with somewhere like Iceland, who actually invested more in its social protection programs, we can see that there were over 45,000 additional deaths attributable to funding cuts during that period between 2010 and 2014, whereas there were no additional deaths attributable to the 2008 recession in Iceland. In fact, the health might even have improved. So this demonstrates the importance of political decisions in determining the outcomes associated with times of low or no economic growth. So it's in that context that myself and other researchers in my field ask this critical question of how we can meet the Paris Agreement emissions reductions targets, reduce our impact on the global environment, and keep people healthy, happy, and prosperous. Quite a large challenge. Importantly, however, we must remember that a post-growth economy is not the same as a recession. The ways in which we structure our institutions and our social and physical environments have the potential to dramatically change the social outcomes that come with a non-growing economy. I spent 2 months earlier this year speaking with experts in my field who are dealing with exactly this problem of welfare without growth. They really took a wide range of views on the topic, and they discussed the ways in which this touches our lives in multiple areas. Some experts talked about the ways in which we can reduce the dependence of our hospitals, our schools, and our social protection programs on economic growth. Other experts talked about the ways in which we need to alter the physical and social architecture of our societies to make sustainable and healthy choices not only possible but easy. about the importance of redistributing wealth to support well-being and relieve pressure on the crisis functions of the state. Now, there will be no one post-growth economy switch that will shift us onto a sustainable pathway. Transitioning towards a post-growth economy requires complex and far-reaching changes. We need new working structures that will allow us to job share and work from home. We need good, well-connected, timely public transport and all the infrastructure that goes along to support that. We need to invest in renewable energy. We need huge redistribution of wealth, and we need it all yesterday. But if we dare to think beyond the current economic modes of functioning, and if we dare to accept the limits of this physical planet that we live on, we can turn that incredible force of human ingenuity towards solutions which are based on principles of sustainability and equity on a finite planet. Thank you.
As a statistician and economist myself, then I'm wondering, how is it possible that in the long term the economic growth is higher if there is a higher emission? Because if there are clear challenges, then we should see in the long term that economic growth is brought about sensibly with sustainability in the mix. So that's a question for the researchers, but I'd like to invite also Dimitri.